God bless you and welcome you back here into the telecast. It's so good to have you here today and you for the first time. This is the School of Christ International Telecast, a mission functioning, made disciples in over 145 countries of the world. It's not a person. They don't find it's not Clendenin ministry. It's a School of Christ, exalting the Christ. Said they went everywhere preaching Christ and they reached their world. Well, that has been the key with this School of Christ. You'll find on there on the screen the website there where we are. You can see where we are, what we're doing. Many places not listed because it's just not forbidden. It's forbidden for us to be there. But you can see who we are, what we are. You can contact us. Now, this series of lessons that we've been bringing, that I felt so much that God wanted me to interrupt everything and bring because of the nearness of the coming of the Lord. Those foolish virgins must be awakened to where they are, out of their carelessness, not being absorbed with themselves. That's what made them careless. They thought they had some things more important than the will of God. They absolutely knew when that trumpet sounded that they'd run out of oil. They knew that because the first thing they said, there's no oil in our vessel. But they refused to do anything about it. The tragedy of neglect can never be overstated, you see. Amen. Because of that, that self thought it had more important things to do than to obey God. Now, in our last lesson, we brought this out with Abraham, Isaac, and Ishmael, how all of that was a parable. And we brought out how the self brought Peter to where he was. We ended up with Jonah, his selfishness, so afraid that somebody's going to think he's a false prophet that he wept while 600,000 people got saved by his preaching. That is a terrible, terrible thing of self. Now, I want to deal more with this effect of self. Amen. Now, you know in Genesis 3 and 5, the devil said to Eve, you'll be like God. You see, self dishonors God. That's the effect of it. And it sets up a rival on God's throne. And the devil is not altogether a liar when he said to our first parents, you will be like God. See, this is just what fallen man tries to be. God in himself. This is the essence of the sin of selfishness. For it puts man in the place of God by making him a law and an end in himself. Now, whenever a person acts for his own selfish will or self-interest purely as an end, he's claiming to be his own God. Now, I've made mention of this. But I know there's many of you that are listening to me today. But I've watched, and I've been a preacher for 56 years. I've preached this same glorious gospel of Christ. God's helped me along the line to learn a little more, look a little further into it. But I've watched preachers change churches every 2 years. That preacher, he's not interested in the will of God. He's not seeking the will of God. His whole thing, looking for a bigger salary, a better place to live, and more things of this world. That, listen, he's claiming to be his own God. He is directly disobeying the first commandment, you'll have no other gods before me. But when I live for this self, or you live for this self, then you have become your own God. That's exactly what happened to Adam in the fall. That devil said you'll be his God. He wanted what God said you cannot have. And his own desire overrode the desire to please God. I watched in the election here in America. I watched millions of people who claim to be Christians vote for a man that believes that a woman has a right to murder a baby after that baby is born. Now, watch that. Those same people you talk to them said, I don't let politics and my religion mix. Not a matter of politics, mister. It's a matter of conviction. It's a matter that you prefer because you believe that man may give you $25 more a month than you'd vote for yourself. That's all that is. Amen. Moreover, in assuming the place of God, he is doing it in a spirit of completely contrary to God's spirit. God is love, and love is the exact opposite of selfishness. He is thus mocking God and at the same time proving his utter unfitness to occupy his throne by his unlikeness to him. That's the reason God put this on my heart, to bring it to you across this world. It's to him that overcometh that's going to sit in that throne with God. Amen. And you must overcome that self. The first act of a disciple is unselfishness. He must deny himself. You see, self always leads to every other sin and brings back the power of the carnal life. Self alone attempts to keep the heart, but it finds sin and Satan too strong. Self-perfection is not possible for any man. There must be more than I before there can be victory. Now in Romans 7:15, the Apostle Paul tells us what I can do. Listen to it. It can only struggle ineffectively. In the next chapter, 8 and 10, he points the way to triumph and victory. Amen. The man or woman who goes only far enough to receive a Adamic purity, if such a thing is really included in the gospel, will soon have the next chapter of the Adamic history, that is the temptation to fall. God said in Romans 8 and 14, if we walk in the Spirit, that's the only pathway of overcoming this self. But the person who received Christ to dwell within and to keep the heart by his mighty power shall rise to the fullness of Christ, according to Ephesians 4 and 13. Still further, the self-life that leads back to the dominion, the self-life leads back to the dominion of Satan. Satan's own fall probably began in the form of self-love, made to be dependent upon God every moment he desired independence. How much of that do I see in the 21st century church? They desire God to be a Santa Claus to them. They only want their own selfish desires and everything about the church. What is in it for me? Not what can I give to God? You know, contemplating his own perfection and thinking it was something that was his own. He becomes separated from God and fell into rebellion against God himself. This led to the eternal rivalry, disobedience, and all that can be opposite to the divine and the holy. Satan become that. Any person who becomes occupied with his or her own virtues and tries to be independent of Jesus will fall under the power of Satan and share his awful descent. Jesus must be our source of strength and the supreme end of our being. Self is likewise fatal to the spirit of love and harmony. It is a source of strife, bigotry, suspicion, sectarianism, envy, jealousy, and the whole race of social sins and grievances that afflict the Christian life in the Church of God. It is a mother. Selfishness is a mother of division from the beginning. Where it prevails, there can be no true unity and no happy cooperation. There can never be a harmonious church or a happy family where self is predominant in the hearts of the people. Jesus, help us to hear. The secret of Christian cooperation and happy church life is bearing with one another in love, making every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace, and learning to honor one another above ourselves. Self mars all work for God. This is the effect of it. That's what we're talking about. It mars all work for God. Self will mars our work for God and tries to force God's power and grace upon our own sidetracks. God will never permit that. I've watched that. Little Towers of Babel. In my time, I've watched men that gained great prominence among the multitude, were looked upon as great people, build their little society. I've saw them building hospitals that God told them to build that never got built. I've watched all of this come out of self sticking its nose into the things of God. Self-confidence seeks to build up the kingdom of Christ by human ability and unsanctified programs. I've watched it, and I've watched what's happened to the church. It's become a kingdom of strife and a misrepresentation of God. Self presumes to go where God has not sent it and do what he's not qualified it to do. I've watched organizations as through their little Bible schools educate men who never were called to preach, and because they knew certain things, send them forth to do the work of God. It's Aesop's fables all over again, a lower life trying to teach people a higher life. Self presumes to go where God has not sent it. The result is a crude work defiled by worldly sin, impermanent and unfruitful. That is the work that is produced. Much of today's Christian work is of this nature. The spirit of self-glorying will try to use the pulpit, the choir loft, the religious paper, the charitable scheme, and even the mission of winning souls as a channel for magnifying a personality or successful work or by glorifying some rich donor. I've seen it over and over. I heard one at that time of the most successful preachers, I'm not talking about spiritual, but had reached further with what he was preaching than any the other man. And he said, God told me, if I do not evangelize the world, then the world will not be evangelized. Oh, my God, this is where we are. God is disgusted with the spirit of idolatry until we're so yielded to our master that he and he alone can be glorified in our work, that the Lord cannot trust us with much service for him. Self makes us unhappy. It's a root of bitterness in every heart where it rules. The secret of joy is hidden in the heart of love, and the arms of self are too short to reach it. Dear God, if I ever preach the message from God's heart, I believe this series is to deal with that elect of God. You there that have been born and filled with the Spirit of God, yet have become careless in your lives. Amen. You know there was a time in your life when you walked with God in a much more sincere and perfect way. But now, self has come. There's other things that have gained the preeminence in your life and is more important to you than the will of God. And if you don't wake up, you're going to be lost. Until we dwell in God and God dwells in us, until we learn to find happiness in being lost in God, living for his glory and for his people, we'll never taste the sweets of divine blessedness. Only running water is living water. And only when it is poured into vessels does it become wine. The self-willed man is always a miserable person. He gets his own way and does not enjoy it. After he has it, he wishes he'd never got it, because it usually leads him over the precipice. The self-sufficient man can never know the springs that lie outside of his own little heart. And the self-glorying man, like Herod, is eaten up by the worms of corruption and remorse that always feed upon the impious person who dares to claim the honors due to God. How much of that today? God has become a Santa Claus, just somebody to get from. That people don't go to church to give. They're parasites of a pew. Amen. They grumble because they never received, but they never gave anything. They never gave anything. This is where we are. This must be corrected. And if I'm talking to you, and you sense that you've moved away from God, that you once were closer to God than you are now, then you must willfully turn around and repent before God. The boasted wisdom must prove to be foolishness. The self-sufficient boast, such as the one Peter made, must be answered by its own failure. The disobedient path that refuses God's wise and holy will must be proved to be a false way. Every idol must be abolished, every high thing brought low. No flesh may glory in his presence. Let us ask our faithful God to save us from this tyrant of self that dishonors God and leads us to captivity to Satan. Let us ask him now to show us that we're nothing. Then we'll be glad to have Christ to live in us. He who fills everything in every way, according to Ephesians 1:23. There's only one remedy for self. Only one. There are not two, not three. One remedy for self. God is often let self have its way until it cures us effectually by showing us the misery and the failure that it brings. I'm praying to God that we've arrived there. The misery. I have people calling me all the time. Do you know of a church where a man or a woman could really find God? That's what it's become. Because, man, we're in the time of the Laodicean, the last stage of the church. Christ is outside trying to get back in. And this is where we are. This is the only good there is in our struggling. It shows us the vanity of the struggle and prepares us then to surrender us, as to surrender it all to God. But let us beware how much we assert ourselves. Because there's always one step too far that'll prevent us from ever returning. My God, are you listening? Amen. Job talked about, amen, those that were beyond ransom. They'd gone too far. They could never come back into the grace of God. You see, God has placed around us also the restraints of other hearts and lives as checks upon our own selfishness. They're like the links that almost compel us to reach beyond ourselves and work with and live for others. He has made no man independent of his brother. In him the whole building is joined together. Ephesians 2:21. And we grow together in a holy temple in the Lord. We're adjusted bone to his bone. And by that which every joint supplies, the body is ministered to and grows into the fullness of his stature. The church of Christ is no autocracy. It where one can be a dictator or a judge, but it's a fellowship. One alone is the master. Christ is the master. Any work that develops into one man, despotism withers. It is true that God has ranks of workers, but they're all harmonious and linked in heavenly love. The man who cannot work with his brother in mutual comfort and harmony has something yet to learn in his own Christian life. It is our God-given responsibility to submit ourselves one to another in the fear of God. And if we don't get along with one another, then we cannot get along with God. We cannot get along with God. We must submit one to another in the fear of God. You see, one of us may sow, another reap, but both will rejoice together as they carry each other's burdens. And this way, only this way, will we fulfill the law of Christ according to Galatians 6:2. as true yoke fellows, Paul said in Philippians 4:3. You see, the love of Jesus is a divinely appointed prescription for the death of self. Paul expresses this in 2 Corinthians. One died for all, and therefore all died. And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live unto themselves, but unto him who died for them and was raised again. That is a simple story of death of self in the Christian life. It is the love of Jesus that has excluded, and never until we become fascinated by his affection, captivated by his love, will we cease to live for ourselves. Only then. Then we'll toil and suffer with him and follow him anywhere. If we, listen to me, if you listen to me, if we would die to self, we must fall in love with Jesus. Only then will we be content without the many things that before we thought that we must have. Our hearts will be so satisfied with Christ that we cannot speak or even think of it as a sacrifice or suffering. But it's not only the love of Christ that we want. It is the living Christ himself. Many, many people have touches of the love of Christ. But for them, he's a Christ far removed. That's a great, great problem. The Apostle Paul speaks of something far greater. It is Christ himself who lives inside and who is big enough to crowd out and keep by that little eye that you and I are. There is no other who can truly lift and keep the heart above the power of self but Jesus. He is the mighty God, stronger than the armed strongman. He's able to so be our life, listen to me, that moment by moment we'll be conscious that he's filling us with himself and conquering the self that ruled us before. And the more we try to fight self, the more that self clings to us. But that moment we turn away from self, look to Christ, he fills all the consciousness and disperses everything with his own presence. Let us abide in him, and we'll find there's nothing else to do. See, when you see this to be the Spirit's work, it's almost the same thing, but another way of saying it. That the baptism and indwelling of the Holy Spirit will deliver and keep us from the power of self. Walk in the Spirit, and you'll not fulfill the works of the flesh. When the cloud of glory entered the tabernacle, there was no room for Moses to remain. And when filled with the heavenly presence of the blessed Spirit, we're lost in God, self hides away. Like Job, we can say, my ears have heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you. Therefore, despise myself and repent in dust and ashes. These bodies of ours are made for him. Let him fill them so completely that we'll be the oriental temple of glass in the ancient legend that when the sun shined on the temple was not seen. The observer could only behold the glorious sunlight that it reflected. Their transparent walls were all but unnoticed. May we so live that Christ be seen only in us.